Welcome to Inland Edition, where we have community conversations with people who make decisions that affect our everyday lives. My name is Joe Richardson. I'm a community member, an attorney, and your host. And today, we're going to chat with the person at the top of California's educational system. He's the son of a teacher who immigrated from Panama and a soldier who died in the Vietnam War. Tony Thurmond overcame childhood poverty to become the current California State Superintendent of Public Instruction. He's unapologetic, resilient, and driven, and it's time for you to meet him. State Superintendent of Public Instruction, Tony Thurmond. Thank you so much for being here.
Oh, thanks for having me.
Tell me about your aha moment, and maybe there's several of them, that get you on the road to your path of what is a vast and long-standing public service.
You know, it's my 16th year in elected politics, but I would say that the aha moment came in college. Mm-hmm. My buddy asked me to run for student government with him, which I wasn't really interested in. We got elected. I was the vice president, and then ultimately got elected student body president. It was the first time that I believed that you could use politics to make a difference in the community. Mm-hmm. And it would take 20 years before I would ever run for any office, but it was the moment when I knew that I would hope to have a chance to serve my community. And it's just been a great career, and I'm just honored.
Social worker, assembly member, school board member, public school parent.
Yeah.
Tell me how they all converge in your job and inform what you do as a state superintendent of public instruction.
Best part about being a social worker is doing lots of jobs. And I spent a lot of time helping young people who'd been in foster care, young people who'd been in the criminal justice system, helping people with developmental disabilities, doing neighborhood revitalization, making our communities better. All these things were preparing me and training me for service in government. And as a former state legislator, you know, I worked on a lot of bills that I was proud to help write them myself, because I'd worked almost every job you can think of. It gave me just a body of work to draw upon. To be a great advocate for our people. And I wouldn't change a thing. You know, everyone always says you should, you know, do these things if you want to get elected. But to me, there's no one path. You know, you have to follow your own journey and build your own experiences. And the things that I've had the opportunity to do in serving my community have made it possible for me to serve the public. And I'm grateful for all those experiences.
Tell us about what the state superintendent of public instruction actually does. Give us our 101 for those of us that don't know. And would it be oversimplifying to say that you're the public school guy?
Well, I'm just a guy who gets blamed for anything that goes wrong with education. I don't think most people understand the job, because we have 1,000 school districts, and each of those districts has its own superintendent and its own school board. But as a state superintendent, with my headquarters based in Sacramento, I'm able to fight for the people to get the resources that we need for books, for teachers and staff. You know, I get to work with the legislature and the governor every single day to make sure our schools have what we need and to set a vision so that every single student can get a great education. You know, in my life, education has been everything. I've had to overcome a lot of humble beginnings, you know, growing up on the free lunch program, growing up on food stamps and government cheese, and times where we flat out didn't have any food in my household. Overcoming those challenges, there's been one constant for me, and that's education. And they helped to turn things around for me. And I want that for all 6 million of our students. So as state superintendent, I get to be the number one advocate for our schools, to champion causes to get us, you know, universal meals for other hungry students, preschool for every 3- and 4-year-old, and to make sure we have 10,000 counselors to support the mental health needs of our students. And so it's a tremendous honor. And I'm grateful to be able to serve the people of California.
You said that there's 1,000 school districts. There's 6 million kids in public schools. Tell us how you who you interface with and how in your job.
You know, formally, there are 58 county superintendents who all run a local office of education. I talk to a lot of them. I talk to a lot of local school district superintendents and school board members, and of course, legislators and the governor, and we work on educational policy. But informally, most of the constituents that I hear from, I meet in the grocery store. Mm-hmm. And they come up to me and they say, Tony, can I talk to you? And they say, I've got an issue. My student needs help. I don't spend any time trying to explain to them how our system works. I just take down their number and say, let me follow up with you and we'll get this done. And sometimes I think about it. Of course, my family won't go to the grocery store with me because I can't get through an aisle without getting stopped halfway through. But if that's the only way that someone has a chance to meet an elected official who works for them, I'm okay with that.
I used to have a teacher in high school in English who used to always say, look for the dramatic irony of a story. It seems this way, but it's actually this way. Talk about any ironies that you have seen or surprises for all of the experience that you've had, maybe looking, certainly looking at education through a window, doing things directly related to education. Some of the things that you've picked up on that have been things that have been surprising or ironic or crazy.
Let me think about the crazy. but if I could start with a personal experience, I grew up as a very quiet and shy student and was very uncomfortable with people constantly asking me why I'm so quiet. And, you know, there's some life circumstances. I lost my only parent to cancer when I was 6 years old, my mom. My dad was a Vietnam vet who never came home from the war. I was raised by my cousin who I met when I showed up on her doorstep for the very first time. And so, you know, starting out early on, I was trying to overcome trauma and difficult challenges, and it was hard for me to find my voice. But people kept coming to me and giving me responsibility. They kept talking to me about the promise of education and what it would do for my life. And that promise has been kept. And along the way, I found my voice. And I find myself in a job that has a big microphone to use to amplify the needs of other students who've been in similar situations to me. And so it is ironic that, you know, this quiet, shy kid trying to overcome adversity has been given the opportunity to be a voice for others, for parents who are looking for ways to be involved.
In your job, you say, we're going to fill in that gap because this student may be, statistically speaking, missing X or Y or Z. Connect those dots for us in terms of what you find when you look at the profile of a student in the state of California.
Well, we have great students, and I get to visit lots of schools, and what I see all the time are students who just have a hunger and a desire to learn. They want an opportunity to know what's in their future. They want to know how I got into my job. They want to be able to talk about opportunities in just about every profession. And we have resources to ensure that every student can get on a pathway. We call it career technical education, and, you know, we talk about college and career. We have ways to support any student on what they want to do. You know, there's so many jobs that we need to fill right now that will go unfilled unless we do more around computer science, you know, cybersecurity, you know, just where everything is going right now with artificial intelligence. You know, students aren't going to be working under the hood of a car if they want to work on a car. They have to know how to service the robots that help to build the car. And we have to make sure that we're providing them with that experience so that what they learn keeps up with where industry is going, where the sector is going, so they're prepared to walk into those jobs. But our students have all the talents to do all the things that we need done to continue making California the leader of all states in our great nation.
Let's talk about virtual learning, because I saw this with my wife, who is a speech therapist. And so she basically delivered services online when you really count on being able to provide those services directly and there being, you know, interaction between students. And there's an argument that there's no replacement for that.
That's right.
But we needed to do virtual. And so here we are a couple, 3 years, you know, down the road. And most of us, you know what Zoom is intimately, for better or for worse. Talk about how we strike that balance in terms of here's what we do better, here are the platforms that we have to help. However, dealing with parents' concerns about wanting the option to be virtual or not wanting to be back in classrooms, how do you support that dichotomy and that balance given what we learned through COVID and what we did by necessity?
Yeah. Let me first just say there's no replacement for in-person instruction. Mm-hmm. You know, we're social people. We need to be connected. And we see how many were impacted by the loss of connection at a time when we couldn't be connected for public health reasons and that we needed to keep everyone safe. And so thank you to your wife and to all the teachers and classified staff who did all that they could to keep our students connected. And because of the way the pandemic, you know, how coronavirus ebbed and flowed, there were times when we thought it was safe to be open for in-person instruction, and other times, you know, when COVID rates would soar again, people would have to go back into remote learning. And so because we've had this experience, I think that we can use the technology to complement what we provide in in-person instruction. Again, there's no way to place what a great teacher at the head of the classroom does for our students. We can all think about great teachers in our lives. You know, I often think back to my own experience struggling in mathematics. And I had a great teacher named Mrs. Harrell in high school who just said, "You're gonna get this." And she sat with me until I got it. And there was a lot of time until I got it. And everyone can think of some teacher in their life who provided that. And so we'll never be able to replace that. But we can use technology to complement that and to help prepare our students for great futures.
How do you connect the dots to allow us to turn the corner as much as we can and show a future for the young folks using all of the things that California has that we can use to our advantage?
Yeah. You know, one of the things I'm working on right now is how do we get more paid internships for our high school students so they can learn about career pathways. We call it career technical education. That just means that they get on a pathway to learn about some career that they wouldn't know about until they've had an opportunity to do so. We have to partner with industry and with the technological sector to make sure that what students learn in classroom is complemented by real-world knowledge and hands-on knowledge. And so if not, then we will fall behind because the technology is changing every single day. Now students are writing papers using ChatGPT. They're writing papers as we speak. Now, I'm not encouraging that. Anybody who's watching this, I'm not encouraging you to use AI to write your paper, okay? Do the work, and when you need help, ask for help. But these are tools that can be used, and if we don't have access to those tools in the sector as they're being launched and developed, what we teach our students runs the risk of falling behind. It's also difficult because we don't have enough teachers who can teach computer science. We need more engineers. We need more folks with computer science backgrounds. And right now we're offering scholarships for anyone who wants to become a teacher, whether it be in computer science or bilingual education, early education. Right now we're offering a $20,000 scholarship to anyone in our state who would like to become a teacher or a counselor. All you have to do is send a message to us at teachinca@cde.ca.gov, and we'll walk you through the process of how to get access to the scholarship, to get a teaching credential or a counseling credential. We have some undergraduate scholarships for those who want to become tutors or counselors as a way of working in a school, and they can get paid while they learn and they get money to go to school as an undergraduate. I would say that one of the biggest opportunities and challenges that we have right now in public education all across the country is to recruit the workforce.
We are a leader. California is a leader. And often we are a proving ground for things that other states will then follow suit and do themselves because they saw us do it. So what are those things that you are proud of and want California to do as leader so that they can be templates for the rest of the country?
Very, very proud of how California is building back from the pandemic. Every state has been impacted in the same way, but no other state has put forward the resources that California has. You know, as I said, I was a student who grew up on the free lunch program, and we often didn't have food in my household. It means a lot to me to be ensuring that every one of our students now can get two meals a day for free, regardless of their background or their neighborhood. There are no paperwork requirements. We call that universal meals. And that means anyone who wants a meal will be able to get those meals. We have universal preschool in our state so that we can provide early education for every 3- and 4-year-old in our state. This is something that many of us have worked on for decades. It hasn't existed, and now California offers the resources to make this happen. But we have great challenges that we must work through to continue to be a leader. We have got to keep the American dream alive and make housing affordable for anybody who wants it. I'm actually sponsoring a bill that would build affordable housing for school staff, because our school staff can't afford to live where they work. And by the way, we have to do that for all of our workforce, for first responders and nurses and teachers and classified staff and folks in all sectors. We've got to address the issues of homelessness and crime and safety. We've got to prepare our students for the jobs of tomorrow and make sure that everyone can earn a great living to be able to stay in this state. That is a challenge that we face.
So fill in the blank for me, and if it's a long answer, that's perfectly fine. For all we have and for all we've done,
yes.
If I had X,
yeah.
We would really be able to maximize the potential of California students.
Yeah.
What are we missing?
You know, we have so many students who live in poverty, who are impacted by homelessness. The 200,000 homeless students, I think that number is probably higher. It's difficult to get a count. We need more resources from the federal government to support them. And we need a solution because the 8,000 homeless students who are on their own are at the greatest risk for becoming homeless adults. I think in California, we have to say that it's not okay for us to just step over people who are sleeping on the concrete or living in a box. I think that we have to say that's not okay, and we have to find solutions that will work. These are not, you know, easy issues to deal with, but we have to say that we're not going to allow that to be part of our experience, and that we will make sure that someone who is homeless gets access to supportive housing and access to the mental health supports that they need. We have to talk more about mental health, and I just want to say for anyone who is looking for help, that there are resources 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. You can text or call this number, 988, to get help and get connected by a professional to someone who can help you with your mental health needs. We have to have empathy for each other. You know, we're living in a time where we're seeing acts of hate rise all across our country. We have to make a statement that says in California, we don't ban books. That we want our students of color and LGBTQ plus students and students from all backgrounds to have access to inclusive education, because it's not woke education, as some have called it. Inclusive education means that students do better academically and socially. And so I'm very proud of a bill that we are championing right now that would impose a fee on any district that bans a book, because I don't think that book banning is in the traditions of California. We have to send the message to the rest of the country that we can have conversations even when we disagree. We can disagree without being disagreeable, without there being violence, without there being acts of hate, and that our students are going to be the better for it because we role model them for them how to talk about difficult issues, and we give them access to an inclusive education that reflects the beautiful diversity of our state. It's one of the things that is so special about our state is the diversity. And we can't allow anyone to invert that or to treat that as a negative, because it is a great positive. You know, work from the heart, support each other, so we can all have a great experience in this great state.
I want to talk about the Inland Empire. You know, we're in this area, we're in this county that is actually the biggest in landmass in the country, bigger than most states. But I got to tell you, we often feel under-resourced, and it's more than a notion. So tell us how, you know, for folks here in the Inland Empire that want to understand how Tony Thurmond's work in Sacramento and his department affects us here in the Inland Empire in a real way, and how you see us.
I think the Inland Empire is a special place, and I think as California grows, what we do in the Inland Empire can be an example of what we do for the rest of the state. As you point out, the Inland Empire has great diversity of people. is one of the fastest growing regions of people in terms of population, probably some of the fastest growing population statistics anywhere in the country in terms of growth. And so that's a tremendous opportunity to build on what's here. You have universities, you have a medical school, you have great people, you have a great workforce, you have a great quality of life. We have to build on that. We have to create job sectors that allow people to earn a decent living where they can provide for themselves and their families. You have great schools here that focus on STEAM education, bilingual education. We have to grow that. You know, during the pandemic, we worked to get computers and hotspots for many of the students and families here. But like any area, we have to make sure that we create job opportunities, we address poverty and inequity that exists. I really do think, as goes the Inland Empire, so goes the rest of our state because of its size, the growth, and the diversity, and the tremendous opportunity that exists here.
You have an enormous responsibility. I mean, that's a little bit of an understatement because education is so fundamental and so important. I actually remember my mom telling me, I asked her once, why do you always stay up with me and do homework and things like that? She said, because my mother couldn't read and she couldn't help me. And I know how important this is. What do you do in those inevitable tough moments to push through and to keep going?
I think about my grandparents and the sacrifices that they made for me and for my family. You know, my grandmother was born in Colombia and emigrated to Panama and got married as a teenager, had kids and cleaned people's houses to make a living. She sacrificed to help her children have a better life, including my mom, who became a teacher ultimately. I think about my cousin who worked as a nurse's aide while she raised me and my younger brother. You know, she didn't know us. She took us in, kept us out of the streets. Well, she kept us on lockdown, but she kept us out of harm's way, and she insisted that we get an education, even when she didn't have a formal education. I think about my dad, who, while I didn't get to know him, served our country in Vietnam and is decorated and cared deeply about this country, and that he, like me, a descendant of slaves who settled in places like Mississippi and Detroit, you know, looking for the opportunity to live the American dream. I think about soldiers who come from the Inland Empire. I'm thinking about a soldier who was buried in the Riverside Cemetery named Mr. Acevedo, who is a World War II veteran who went to liberate the Jews and ended up serving in a prisoner camp of war, being a beacon of hope for other people who, you know, to me is one of the great examples of people from the Inland Empire and in our history that our students should know about who don't get the opportunity. I think about those who sacrificed. I think about those who went before me. And so, yeah, when I'm having a rough day, I think about people whose lives were on the line every single day, who made the ultimate sacrifice so that we can get an education, have a chance to earn a decent living. And I still have hope. We have a lot of work to do, but I still have hope that we can build something that's better.
So if somebody wants to follow up, where do they go? What's our follow-up to find out more about what we've been talking about here today?
You know, they can always visit us on the California Department of Education website. Lots of information about what's happening. I'm happy to hear, you know, hit me up directly, tony@tonythurmond.com. I'd love to get your email and hear from you. You know, you've already given us an opportunity to talk about these great scholarships that exist. But, you know, the process for how to become a teacher is complicated. And we'd like an opportunity to explain it for folks and to make it easier. And so if part of the homework assignment could be just to get the word out about our one-stop way to help anyone who wants to become a counselor in our schools or a teacher at the teachinca@cde.ca.gov. And then I would add one more homework assignment that if you would do, and I know you're already doing this, is open up this beautiful studio to students to have a chance to come and learn even more about what it means to work in public broadcast so they understand the importance of a KBCR and what that means to the community, just to learn something that they wouldn't know about a career. You know, our state has just given us, through a measure called Prop 28, has given us almost $1 billion every year for arts and music education. And that's great, but if we don't create the opportunities for students to learn about every aspect of arts and music education, to see what it's like to work in a great studio like this, how do we prepare the next hosts and the next journalists who will be conducting this interview? And then I would just say, if there's ever an opportunity for me to do something to promote, you know, public television and radio, to promote the work of the Inland Empire, or to support any of the students, families who are in the citizenry of the Inland Empire, to call on me, and the state superintendent will have your back.
The state superintendent of public instruction, Tony Thurmond, thank you so much.
Thank you.
And I want to thank you guys for watching us on Inland Edition. Thanks for going with us down the road to building a better community, one conversation at a time. See you next time.